Hi, I'm Ann Christensen. Welcome to Learn Windows 95, Internet, Email, Faxing, and More. Today we're going to explore many of the advanced capabilities that Windows 95 has to offer. And who better to teach us about Windows 95 than two of the world's foremost Windows experts, the software guys, Keith White and Tom Jaffe. Keith and Tom spent a combined 12 years at Microsoft as Windows managers. They've trained the Microsoft sales force and traveled the world lecturing about Windows to audiences of all sizes and skill levels. Today, Keith is working out of the office, and Tom is working at home, so they can help you master the skills that you'll need when you're working in your business office or at home with your PC. One of the great things about video training is that you can learn at your own pace. So whenever you need a break or a quick review, don't hesitate to press the stop and rewind buttons on your VCR. Now that we've covered the logistics, let's get started by going online with the Microsoft Network. Okay, guys. Now, you pointed out the Microsoft Network icon in your Getting Started video, but now we're getting ready to dig into it further.
The Microsoft Network, or MSN as you can see on its icon, is Microsoft's own online service. It's similar to CompuServe, Prodigy, or America Online. The Microsoft Network is loaded with tons of information on thousands of subjects.
With the Microsoft Network, you can send and receive electronic mail, you can enter a chat room on a particular topic and type messages back and forth with other people around the world who are also interested in that topic, and you can even purchase products straight from your computer with online shopping. Perhaps the most important benefit on the Microsoft Network is that you can also access the internet. And once you're on the internet, you can surf the World Wide Web. All this right from the comfort of your home or wherever you and your PC happen to be.
Sounds great. So what do I need to do to get online with the Microsoft Network?
Well, with Windows 95, it's really easy to get online with the Microsoft Network. All you need is a modem and a phone line. Now, I'd recommend a 14.4 KBOD modem to get the best performance, and you should have at least 8 megabytes of RAM to get decent performance from the Microsoft Network. Then all you have to do is double-click on the Microsoft Network icon and answer a few questions to sign up.
Is there anything confusing about signing up for the MSN?
Maybe one thing. Now, when you're signing up for the Microsoft Network, you have to select a unique username and password for yourself. You can start by typing in your full name, but if there's another person with the same name as you who is already registered on the Microsoft Network, the bad news is that you'll have to come up with a different name for yourself, like extending your last name.
For example, my username is Tom J.A. I wasn't the first Tom or even the first Tom J to sign up for the Microsoft Network, so my username became Tom J.A. Keith's username is Keith W.
Next, you'll need to create a password so that no one else can log in under your name. Your password needs to be at least 8 characters, and be sure to pick one that you'll remember, because if you forget, you'll have to call the technical support staff at the Microsoft Network to log you back in. Now, your password can be any combination of letters and numbers, and you can use caps or lowercase. You'll also be asked a few more questions, such as, what's your credit card number? Now, once you've answered these questions, you're ready to connect to the Microsoft Network.
Well, so far this is pretty straightforward. Now, let's take a look at the content.
Let's sign on and take a look. You'll notice that you need to type in your password the first time you connect, but by clicking this Remember My Password box, you won't have to type it in each time.
When you connect to the Microsoft Network, the first thing you'll see is the MSN Today screen. This gives you information on different events that are happening on the Microsoft Network each day. For example, today we see America East is having a flight simulator race. There's information on the descent from Jupiter, and there's some great info on the business and finance guidebook.
You can close the MSN Today screen by clicking on the X in the upper right-hand corner. The next screen you'll see is the MSN Central. This is your starting place to all the information on the Microsoft Network, and the bars here represent the places to go on the network. Notice we can go back to the MSN Today screen we just saw by clicking on the MSN Today bar. Or we can send and receive electronic mail to people all over the world via the internet. We'll show you how to use email in Module 3.
Favorite Places allows you to set up shortcuts to your favorite spots on the MSN. With member assistance, we can get technical support, check our account status to see things like how much time we spent online this month, and we can even give suggestions on how to improve the Microsoft network.
Notice as the mouse pointer moves over each icon in the MSN central screen, it turns into a hand, meaning that we can single-click on that item to get to that selection. But most people spend the bulk of their time in categories. This is where the MSN lists all the content that's available by different categories. Let's click on the Categories button. Here we can see all the broad categories of information that are available on the MSN, such as arts and entertainment, business and finance, news and weather, sports and recreation, and computers and software. But now, when we move the arrow over the top of the different category icons, it stays as an arrow, meaning that if we want to get into that information, we need to double-click. In each of these categories, you'll find different sources of information, chat areas where you can communicate with others, and you'll find discussion forums to post comments or questions.
Now, that leisure and hobbies category looks inviting to me. Can we take a look at what's in there?
Sure can. Let's double-click on interests, leisure, and hobbies. There are a number of topics located here, such as arts and crafts, outdoor activities, and since we're interested in travel, let's double-click on it. Next, we see a lot of travel-related items, such as information on theme parks, Australia. United Airlines has some content up here, as well as the Travel Forum.
You'll also find the toolbar at the top of the screen to be very helpful for navigating around the MSN. If you don't see the toolbar, choose View, Toolbar to bring it up. With the toolbar, you can go quickly back or up one level, jump all the way back to the MSN central screen, where you're one click away from any of these topics. You can add an item you find interesting to your Favorite Places folder, or go directly to your Favorite Places folder, which we'll talk about in a couple of minutes.
What if I don't see what I'm looking for in the category screen? Is there an easier way to find a specific topic?
The easiest way to find the information you're interested in is through the Find option. Click on the Tools menu and choose Find, then select On the Microsoft Network. Just type in the topic you're interested in. For example, I'm interested in finding the latest news about Microsoft Excel. Find will search the name, the topic, and the description of the item if you like. We'll just search for Microsoft Excel in name and topic, and the Microsoft Network shows us all the information on Excel. To get to the Microsoft Excel 95 forum, just double-click.
Tom, what are some of the things that you use the MSN for?
Well, we could spend hours easily going through all the information that's available up there, and there's more being added every day. But I like to click around in the categories area and use the Find tool to type in topics that I'm interested in. A couple of areas that I do use quite a bit are the Windows 95 support desktop, which you can find by clicking on, in order, Categories, Computers and Software, Computer Companies and Organizations, Software Companies, Microsoft, Microsoft Windows 95, and Microsoft Windows 95 Support Desktop. I also like to read movie reviews by clicking on Categories, Arts and Entertainment, Movies, Microsoft Cinemania Connection, and Movie Reviews.
That's a lot of levels to click through. Now, do you have to double-click on all those folders every time you want to get to your favorite topics?
Not at all. You should only have to find things once. That's what the Favorite Places section in MSN Central is for. If I get to the Microsoft Windows 95 support desktop, for example, and click on the Add to Favorite Places button, it places the icon in my Favorite Places section. To get to my Favorite Places, we just click on the Go to Favorite Places button on the toolbar, and here's our Microsoft Windows 95 support desktop icon. Now, when I have a question about Windows, I can look here to get a quick answer instead of calling the Microsoft technical support line.
Now here's another tip for getting to important MSN items very quickly. Just like with a file, folder, or program in Windows 95, you can create a shortcut on your desktop to any MSN item. For example, let's say you'd like to read the movie reviews every Friday so you can figure out what to see over the weekend. All you have to do is drag and drop the MSN icon for movie reviews to your desktop. This automatically creates a shortcut to the movie reviews folder. So now, when you want to read movie reviews, just double-click on the icon. Notice that even if you're not connected to the Microsoft network, Windows 95 asks you to sign in and then takes you directly to the movie reviews folder.
You also mentioned that we can talk with other people who have similar interests. Can you show us how to do this?
There are four ways to talk with others over the Microsoft network. Bulletin board services, known as BBSs, live chat rooms, discussion forums that are on the MSN, and email.
Now, what's the difference between each of those?
Bulletin board services are where people can post questions or answers on various topics, just like you would with a real bulletin board. MSN has a wide variety of BBS topics, such as the Worldwide Travel BBS. Chats are where you can type messages back and forth with people in real time, or you can be a spectator and just read what other people are typing or saying. And you can satisfy your urge to chime in whenever you have something to say. Discussion forums are sometimes called town meetings because they typically have a featured speaker and attendees that can post questions in a queue and wait for a response.
Let's take a look at the Worldwide Travel BBS. Here we can see all the questions or discussion points people have asked concerning traveling around the world. The items with the plus signs next to them indicate that these postings have responses to them. If we click on the plus sign, the item expands so we can see those responses. To read the original postings, just double-click on it. We can read each reply by clicking on the down arrow, and we can even reply to those postings by clicking on the Reply to BBS button.
Okay, so you can post messages and chat with people on the MSN, but what if I want to send a message to someone like my mother-in-law in California?
Now, the best way to communicate with other people is via electronic mail. The Microsoft network comes with its own email package called Microsoft Exchange. When you subscribe to the Microsoft network, you can use Exchange to send and receive electronic mail. You can communicate with anyone else on the internet who has email as well, as long as you know their email name. And using email is much faster than mailing a letter, and it costs a lot less than sending a fax.
So if I want someone to send email to me, how do I know what my email name is?
Oh, it's easy. Your email name is your username on the Microsoft network. In my case, TomJA, followed by the at symbol, and then followed by msn.com. So Keith's email name is keithw@msn.com. The last tip for now is that you can disable the MSN Today page. The MSN Today page comes up by default, but you may find that you don't use it very often and you'd rather not spend the time waiting for it to download every time you sign on to the Microsoft network. So to disable the MSN Today page, from within the Microsoft network, choose View, Options, and uncheck the Show MSN Today Title on Startup option. Now, when you start up the Microsoft network, it goes straight to the MSN Central page.
Well, now that you know how to cruise the Microsoft network, feel free to take a break here and find a couple of topics that interest you and add them to your favorite places. When we come back, we'll continue online as the software guys show you how to access the internet. The Microsoft network looks great. There's loads of information up there, but I'm a little confused. Could somebody explain the difference between the Microsoft network and the internet?
The internet consists of thousands of computers around the world that are all connected together. Each of these computers can publish information, and when they do, it's available to anyone else on the internet who can find it.
Think of the internet as a public highway with lots of roadside attractions that anyone can stop and look at whenever they want. The MSN is just one of those roadside attractions that happens to be loaded with some great things to do. But to see the MSN attractions, you have to pay an admission fee. It's kind of like an amusement park. Microsoft finds lots of interesting content to post on the MSN, and then it makes sure that it's always up to date.
Now, to use the internet, you also need to pay an admission fee to an internet service provider. This gives you access to the internet. Then, once you're on the highway, you can go anywhere you want. This is just like paying a toll before you get on the highway. Now, the MSN, in addition to being an amusement park on the internet, is also an internet service provider. So, if you subscribe to the Microsoft network, you get to use all the information that Microsoft maintains, but you can also go outside of the MSN and go wherever you want to on the information superhighway, or the internet.
So, the internet is a huge public system with tons of good and bad information, whereas the MSN is a private system where Microsoft chooses what information to post on the network, and they make sure that all the information is interesting and current. And if you subscribe to the MSN, you also get to use the internet. Okay, so what is this World Wide Web we keep hearing so much about?
The internet has several different services, such as email, bulletin board services, and the World Wide Web. The World Wide Web is the graphical information, or pictures, that you can access on the internet. The web is the part that so many information publishers are using today to post their content. Let's take a look. Here is Microsoft's homepage. If I click on any item on this page, such as products, it takes me to another page with information all about Microsoft's products. But to view the World Wide Web, you need to install another software program called a browser. The one that comes with the Microsoft Network for free is called the Internet Explorer. To install the Internet Explorer, go to Categories, open the Internet Center folder, and double-click on Getting on the Internet. Click on Upgrade Instructions, and you're on your way. Now, once the Internet Explorer is installed, you'll see an icon for it on your desktop. And as long as you have an MSN account, all you need to do is double-click on it to start surfing the net. When you double-click on the Internet Explorer, you'll see the same sign-on screen you have for the Microsoft Network, and that's because you're using the Microsoft Network as your Internet service provider.
When the Internet Explorer first appears, it defaults to the Microsoft Network's Welcome to the Internet page. This will allow you to jump to a number of places, including Microsoft product information, product support, and software downloads.
Let's take a look at the toolbar in the Internet Explorer, where you'll find the buttons that you use most often. The forward and back buttons allow you to quickly go back to the previous screens you've looked at, or move forward once again through these screens. For example, let's click on the Microsoft products option. Notice how your pointer turns into a hand. And remember, that means you just need to single click. Now, to go back to where I just was, just click on the back arrow. To go back into the Microsoft product section, just click on the forward arrow.
You can quickly get back to the Welcome to the Internet page by clicking the Open Start Page button on the toolbar.
Now, I know that there are literally millions of pages in the World Wide Web. Can you show me the easiest way to find what I'm interested in?
Believe it or not, the best way to find what you're looking for on the internet is through one of the many search tools located on the internet. Click on the searches graphic, and this will take you to a list of internet searching tools. Now, select one of the search tools, such as Excite, and simply type in the words that describe what you're looking for. For example, I'm thinking about taking a vacation to Greece, so if I type in Greece travel and click on search, it pops up a list of all the websites that have something to do with Greece and travel. Notice how Excite gives me a percentage number next to each finding, which indicates the likelihood that that site will have what I'm looking for.
All of these matches are links to the corresponding website, so to access any of these suggested pages, just click on the underlined title. Anything that's underlined is a link to something else, so just click on it to get there. Let's click on the title that says Yahoo, Regional Countries Greece Travel. Next, we'll click on Hellas, Land of Gods. This takes us to a different page with information on Greece. From here, I could go to yet another document, which contains a tour with pictures, or I could look at a list of museums.
Just like the Microsoft Network, the Internet Explorer can keep a list of all of your favorite websites. When you're at a site that you want to go back to, go up to the toolbar and click on the Add to Favorites button. You can keep the name it offers you, or type in a more descriptive name and click on Add. Now, when you click on the Favorites menu, you'll notice it lists the name of our site, Greek Tourist.
And also, like the Microsoft Network, you can drag and drop shortcuts to your desktop in order to quickly log on to the internet and go directly to that website. For example, I may want to go back to the Helis homepage. Let's reduce the size of this window by clicking on the Restore button in the upper right-hand corner. Now I can see my desktop. I'll then drag and drop the underlined title or link to the desktop. Notice this creates a shortcut icon on my desktop that I can just double-click on and be connected directly back to the page.
Well, so even though there are millions of documents, it is pretty easy to browse and find information you need on the internet and to make shortcuts to quickly get to your favorite places. Do you guys have a favorite site?
Well, Microsoft's Windows 95 site always has some great information. And USA Today's site, it's literally up-to-the-minute information. The White House is a great place to see what the president's thinking. But you know, my favorite is the software guy's own homepage on the internet. Just search for winstruck.com.
Thanks for the gratuitous plug, Keith. Well, that completes this section on the internet. Next, we're going to learn how to work with email using Microsoft Exchange. Now that we're online and surfing the net, it's time to find out how to communicate with the rest of the world. Okay, guys, can you explain what electronic mail is?
Electronic mail, or email, is the number one reason why people use the internet. Email is a lot like regular paper mail. With paper mail, you write a letter, you address it, you mail it, and then it goes to the post office, and then it's delivered to your recipient. Email works basically the same way. You type a letter in your email program, you address it using an email address instead of a street address, and when you mail it, it's automatically routed to your recipient's post office. Then when they log in to download their email, the letter arrives in their inbox.
Sounds easy enough, so show us how to send email with Windows 95.
Windows 95 includes an email program called Microsoft Exchange. You can use Exchange to send and receive all of your email, including the mail you exchange inside your corporate network, as well as the email you exchange over the Microsoft Network, CompuServe, or the internet. Now, when you install the Microsoft Network, Exchange is also automatically installed. And when you subscribe to the Microsoft Network, Exchange is automatically set up for you, so you can send and receive email over the Microsoft Network and the internet.
You should see an icon on your desktop labeled Inbox. This is the Microsoft Exchange icon. If you don't see this icon, you'll need to install the Exchange software. So to install the Exchange software, click on the Start button, choose Settings and Control Panel, double-click on the Add Remove Programs icon, and select the Windows Setup tab. Select Microsoft Exchange and click on OK.
What if my company uses a different electronic mail package, like CC Mail? Can I still use it with Windows 95?
Windows 95 supports all of the major mail packages, but if you want to send mail over the Microsoft Network, you have to use Exchange. Exchange, as I mentioned, is a versatile email package, since you can also use it to send and receive mail from the Microsoft Network, fax, and the internet.
Well, now that we have Exchange installed, let's take a look at how it works by double-clicking on the inbox icon on the desktop.
Okay, the first thing I'll point out is that, like with any easy-to-use program, Exchange has a toolbar across the top. The buttons include the Show Hide Folders list, which lets you either display your storage folders on the left or hide them. Now, when you first open Exchange, you won't see these folders, so be sure to click on this button so you can save and organize your messages. There are also buttons to create, print, delete, and reply to your messages. Now, down in the message area, there are column headings showing you who the email was sent from, what the subject is, and the time and date you received the message. You'll also notice some smaller buttons on the left, including a paperclip, which indicates that a message has a file or a picture included in it, and an exclamation point, which indicates that the sender marked their message as important. These bars can also be used to sort your messages when you click on them, which comes in really handy when you're trying to find a message that you stored in one of those folders on the left.
So, Tom, let's say that you wanted to send an email to Keith. Can you show us how to do that?
Sure. To compose a message, just click on the New Message button in the toolbar. A blank new message template appears, and the toolbar changes, so you'll have the tools that you're most likely to use when you're composing and sending a message, such as a button to insert a file into your message, and that exclamation point so you can mark your message as important. Now, in the new message template, there are spaces where you can address the mail to your recipients, carbon copy or CC others who you want to receive the mail, a subject heading so recipients can quickly see what the message is about when they're looking at it in their list in their inbox, and finally, the message area, where you can enter the text into the body of the message. As we talked about before, it's important to know the email address of the people that you're sending the message to, just like you need to know their address if you're sending them a paper letter. Now, typically, email addresses have a person's name, followed by an at symbol, and then the location of their post office. So let's send this message to Keith. Again, his email name is keithw@msn.com.
Can you send the same message to more than one person?
Oh, definitely. Let's say I also wanted to send the message to you, Ann. I can add your email name to the to line by typing a semicolon to separate the names, and then annc@msn.com.
Next, let's add a subject. To move from the to field down to subject, we can click in the box or just press the tab key once to go to the CC line and again to go to the subject line. Let's type in an informative subject like Greek vacation. I'll press tab again and we're ready to type in the body of the message. A nice enhancement in Microsoft Exchange is that it lets us compose messages using different fonts, sizes, colors, bullets, and alignments.
Let's type in as a title, 10 days and counting. We can make this a larger size font, say 16, and center it using our alignment button here on the toolbar.
We'll click on the left alignment button. On the next line, we'll type in, don't forget to renew passport, get traveler's checks, bring sunscreen. And we can bullet this list by selecting these lines and clicking on the bullets button on the toolbar.
Next, I'm going to add our trip itinerary. I'll select it and then go to the toolbar and click on the color palette and change it to red and underline it since it's important. I already created an itinerary in Microsoft Excel, so there's no reason to retype this information into our message. Instead, we can insert the file into the message body by clicking on the Insert File button. This brings up a dialog box that lets me find the Excel file, so I'll double-click on Vacation Plans. Here's the itinerary file, so I'll select it and click OK. Now, the icon for this file is included in our message.
Can you send an attached file to anyone?
Well, just about, as long as their email system knows how to receive an attached file.
Well, I know that you pay for the amount of time that you're connected to the MSN. Can you compose a message if you're not logged in?
Yeah, you sure can. If you care about saving money, you should always read and compose messages while you're offline. And when you're ready to send or receive mail, just connect for the short time it takes.
Instead of first logging on the MSN and then getting your email, go first to your inbox and click Tools and Deliver Now. When you choose this option, Exchange will bring up the MSN sign-in dialog. So click the Connect button to connect to the Microsoft network. Exchange will then send out any mail that's in your outbox and check for new mail you may have received since the last time you logged in. Once that's done, it disconnects you from the Microsoft network automatically. It looks like I've received a couple of new messages.
How can you tell?
Well, there are two ways. First, you'll notice on the taskbar an icon showing an envelope indicating that I have new mail. Second, the new messages in the inbox are bold, which indicates that I haven't read them yet. So to read a message, just double-click on it, and if we scroll down, we can see the attachment that Tom sent.
So when we receive our message, how can we see what's inside the itinerary spreadsheet icon?
Just double-click on the icon, and it starts Excel and loads a spreadsheet.
So how do you reply back to Tom?
Now, there are three buttons on the toolbar that let me do just that. I can reply to just the sender of the message, in this case, Tom. You can reply to everyone who received the message, so both you and Tom would get my response, or I can forward it on to someone else. I'll click on the reply to all, and notice how Exchange automatically inserts the correct email addresses. Now let's type a quick response to Tom. Thanks for the info. And I'll make this bold and green to give it more impact. I'll click the send button to send it off. Now it's important to note that when you send a formatted message, only Microsoft Network or Exchange users will see all the fonts that you're formatting. Users of most other email packages will typically see just plain old courier text.
Now, I'm sure you'll want to save this message so you can make sure you're ready for your trip. Can you tell us how to use the folders on the left to store and organize all your messages?
Sure. The first thing you can do is delete any messages if you don't think you'll need them again. But if you have messages you want to store for future reference, you can set up folders and subfolders to organize these messages. For example, I want to create a vacation plans folder to hold all my vacation information. This should be a subfolder of my personal information folder. To set this up, I'll click on my personal information folder and choose File, New Folder. I'll type in vacation plans and click OK. Notice it creates a subfolder. When I go back to my inbox by clicking on the inbox folder, I can now drag and drop this message about Greece into my new vacation plans folder.
You should also be aware that by default, Exchange saves copies of all the email that you've sent in the sent items folder, and all the mails that you delete are stored in the deleted items folder. So you'll have an archive of all the mail that's ever been in your inbox. Now, after a while, these folders can start taking up a lot of space on your hard disk. So if you need some extra room on the hard disk, these folders would be a good place to start deleting.
Any other tips for using Microsoft Exchange?
Yeah. Since you can use different fonts, sizes, and colors in Exchange emails, you can create your own customized look by changing the default font that you use to compose a new message. So to customize your emails, select Tools, Options, and click on the Send tab. Then choose Font. Let's change mine to Times New Roman, 20 point. Now, whenever I compose a new message, this is how it will appear.
You can also customize your toolbar to contain the items you use most often. For example, remember how we sent mail by clicking Tools, Deliver Now? Well, you can add a Deliver Now button to your toolbar by selecting Tools, Customize Toolbar. On the left-hand side, notice all the functions we can add to the toolbar. Let's scroll down this list to find the Tools Deliver Now button. We'll select it and click on Add. When we click Close, notice the button has been added to the end of the toolbar.
Well, now that's a tip I bet everyone will want to use. In fact, since we've reached the end of our Exchange module, now would be a great time to stop the tape and give it a try. Just take out your booklet and follow the steps. And when we return, the software guys will show us how to send and receive faxes right from your computer.
Microsoft Fax is the fax program that comes with Windows 95, and it happens to be built right into Microsoft Exchange. This means that you can send, receive, and store faxes from the same inbox that you use to send and receive emails.
This sounds like something I've got to have. How do we set it up?
Well, to set up Microsoft Fax, open up Exchange and select the Tools menu. Then choose Services. Click on Add and choose Microsoft Fax from the list. And click OK. Microsoft Fax will tell you you need to fill in some information, so click yes. You'll need to fill out this dialog box with your name, your fax number, your address, etc., under the user tab. And then Microsoft Fax will ask you to choose what type of modem that you're using. So click yes. Choose your fax modem and click on set as active fax modem.
Next, click on the dialing tab to specify how you want local and long distance fax numbers to be dialed. If you need to dial a 9 to get out of your office or hotel room, you can specify that here. Click on the Dialing Properties button and type in the numbers you need to dial to access an outside line. Finally, click on the Message tab. Now this page allows you to specify the time to send your faxes, the default cover page, and make sure you select the option that says, "Let me change the subject line of my new faxes I receive." This allows you to give a title to the faxes you've received to help you organize the ones you want to archive. Click OK and close and restart Microsoft Exchange by choosing File, Exit, and Log Off. Once you've set up the fax program and restarted Exchange, your PC should be ready to send and receive faxes. Notice the new icon on the taskbar that looks like a fax machine. Microsoft Fax is running and waiting to either send or receive a fax. Now it's important to remember that Microsoft Exchange has to be running on your PC for you to receive a fax. It can be minimized to the taskbar or running in the background, but it has to be running to receive faxes.
The easiest way to create a new fax is to click on the Compose menu and select New Fax. This brings up a wizard that walks you through the steps you need to take to send a fax. First, it asks where you're dialing from. This is mostly for laptop users since they can call from wherever they happen to be, so they might want to change the number here. If you have a desktop PC, you should select the option that says, "I'm not using a portable computer, so don't show this to me again." Click on Next, and this is where you can address your fax. We want to send a fax to Winstruct's headquarters, so we'll just type in the name of the recipient, in this case, Winstruct. We'll keep the country as the United States, and then Winstruct's area code and fax number, which is 206-820-8694. Click on Add to List, and if we were sending this to more than one person, we could type in their information here as well, or else we'll just click on the next button.
The next screen asks if we'd like a cover page with the fax. Microsoft Fax comes with 4 pre-designed cover pages that you can choose from, or you can create your own. We'll select the For Your Information page, click on Next, and type in the subject and message that we want to appear on the cover page. Our subject will be Tom and Keith's vacation. And for the text of the cover sheet, we'll type, "Here is our itinerary for the trip to Greece." Click Next, and the screen asks if we want to include a file with the fax. Now, if you've created a document or spreadsheet that you want to fax to someone, just click on the Add File and browse for the file you'd like to send. Our itinerary is located in the Vacation Plans folder on the C drive. Click up a level, then double-click on Vacation Plans. We just double-click on Greece Itinerary, and this adds the file to our fax. When we select Next, our fax is ready to send, and we can click on Finish to send it on its way.
Notice that when you're sending the fax, a dialog box appears in the upper left-hand corner, updating the status of when it's dialing, connecting, sending, and it lets you know that the fax was sent successfully. This dialog box will also appear when you've received a fax. And don't forget, Microsoft Fax is a 32-bit application, which means that while it's sending and receiving faxes, which could take a while if your fax has lots of pages, you can be doing something else with your PC.
And since Fax is part of Microsoft Exchange, the faxes you send will be automatically stored in the same Sent Items folder.
How does receiving a fax work?
When you receive a fax, it looks just like an email message in your inbox. When you have a new fax in your inbox, you'll see the same envelope icon in your taskbar, and just like email messages, the title of the unread fax message will be bold.
Typically, when you receive a fax that was sent from a fax machine or a fax program other than Microsoft Fax, it will appear as a file attachment within the message body. To view the fax, just double-click on the message to open it, and then double-click on the fax icon, and the fax will open inside of the fax viewer. The fax viewer has some tools that make it easier to read the faxes on your computer screen. For example, you can click on the Fit Width button to fill the entire screen. There are also buttons to rotate the fax to the left or right, but since this one came in upside down, we'll choose Rotate, Flip Over. Now, we can click the Printer button to print it out.
Now that we have the fax on our PC, can we edit the text or paste the information into another application?
If you have the right software, you can. There are software packages on the market that do what's called optical character recognition, or OCR. OCR packages intelligently transform the fax into a text that you can edit. Now, Windows does not include OCR software, but if this is something that's important to you, you should ask your local software reseller. However, there are a couple things that you can modify. When you close a fax window, notice that you can edit the subject line. This lets you change the subject from the incoming fax number to a description of what the fax contains. In this case, we received information about our hotels in Greece, so we'll type in hotel info. When we close the message, it asks us if we want to save the changes. And now we can see a new subject and file it into the folders in case we want to look at it at a later time, just like we can do with email.
Now, there's one important exception to what Tom explained about editing faxes. If you receive a fax from another Microsoft Fax user, it will appear in your inbox just like any other fax or email message. But this fax will work just like an email message with formatted text in the body, and any files that they sent will arrive as icons that you can double-click on and edit. For example, here's a fax from Tom about our trip to Greece. Notice I can edit the text in the body, and it comes with an embedded Word document. When I double-click on the icon, the document comes up in Word, and I can make any changes I need to.
So, to sum up, you can use Microsoft Fax to send files straight from your computer to someone else's fax number. If your fax message is received by a standard fax machine, then it'll just print out as usual. But if the receiving fax machine is really another Windows PC, then your fax will arrive in their Exchange inbox as a message that they can edit just like email. This is pretty advanced stuff. But next, we're going to go back to the Stone Age of computers and show you how to run your old MS-DOS-based programs under Windows 95.
Windows 95 has an MS-DOS compatibility module, and Microsoft put a lot of work into making sure that all of your old MS-DOS programs would run even better under Windows 95 than they ran under Windows 3.1. And Windows 95 supports all of your old MS-DOS-based drivers and commands, which means that you can continue using your old sound card or even continue using the MS-DOS prompt to manipulate files or load programs.
Let's take a look at how this works. We'll launch the MS-DOS prompt by clicking on the Start button, choosing Programs, and then selecting the MS-DOS prompt icon. Notice how the MS-DOS prompt appears in a window, and it has a toolbar across the top. This toolbar allows us to do a number of things. First, where it says Auto, this is a drop-down list of the different font sizes we can use for the MS-DOS window. We can change the font size if we want to make the window bigger or smaller, or by leaving it on auto, the font adjusts automatically when we change the size of the window.
The other important buttons on the toolbar are the full screen and the properties buttons. When we click on the full screen button, the MS-DOS window increases to the full size of the screen. Windows 95 is still running behind the MS-DOS window, but we can only see the MS-DOS program. Notice that there's no toolbar here, so you might be wondering, how do we get back to Windows? To put the MS-DOS program back into a smaller window so we can see Windows 95 again, you need to enter the magic key sequence Alt plus Enter. Now, if you're running MS-DOS-based programs, it's important to understand the Properties button. So let's click on the Properties button on the toolbar. The Properties dialog has some functions that most DOS users will want to use to customize the way their program works. For example, you can give your program a shortcut key so you can start it without going through the Start menu. To create a shortcut key, I'll go to the Programs tab, click on the shortcut key window, and type D for DOS. As you can see, it automatically assigns Control-Alt-D to this shortcut. You can also specify what size of a window you want for your DOS program to appear when you first open it. So under Run, you can choose Normal Size Window, Minimize to the Taskbar, or Maximize to cover the entire screen. The Close on Exit box is also important. This allows you to close the MS-DOS program the same way you would close other Windows-based programs by clicking on the X in the upper right-hand corner. So I would recommend that you select this. There are a lot of other choices available in this dialog box, but to keep things short, I'll point out that if you don't know what any of these choices do, such as this Change Icons button, just right-click on it and choose What's This?
That seems like a lot of customizing. Will I have to do that with all my old MS-DOS-based programs?
For most MS-DOS-based programs, you won't need to change any settings because the default settings will work just fine. The settings we showed you are available if you want to customize the way your DOS program works or if it has some special running requirements to run properly.
What do you mean by special requirements?
Well, you may have a DOS program that doesn't seem to work the way it should, or it may not even open at all inside of Windows. If this happens, the first thing you should do is click on the Properties button, and under the Memory tab, you can increase the amount of memory that's allocated to the program.
But if Windows 95 does not recognize your MS-DOS program, you might get an error message stating that the program cannot be run inside of Windows. You can then manually configure the program to use the MS-DOS mode. To do this, click the Properties button, then click on the Advanced button, click on the MS-DOS mode button, and then click OK.
What exactly does this MS-DOS mode do?
Once you configure a program to use MS-DOS mode, when you double-click that program's icon, it causes Windows to close down all the programs that are running. It then shuts Windows all the way down and actually reboots the PC in MS-DOS mode. Now, this is a simplified version of MS-DOS that lacks some of the features that are in the DOS module of Windows.
I see. So the DOS program thinks it's running in an old version of MS-DOS.
Exactly. Now, there's one more tricky part that you may need to know in order to get your DOS programs to run properly. Some DOS programs require a special configuration, such as a specific sound card driver or a CD-ROM driver. In the old world of MS-DOS, these changes were made in two files called autoexec.bat and config.sys. Now, if the DOS program that you want to run inside of Windows 95 requires changes to these files, you can still do this. Click on the Properties button, and in the Programs tab, click on Advanced. Then click on MS-DOS mode. And now you can click on the appropriate window and enter any changes.
So to summarize, Windows 95 will run most of your MS-DOS-based programs with no changes at all. If you have a program that doesn't seem to run quite right, try making changes in the Properties dialog box. And if your MS-DOS program needs special drivers, you can load them in the Properties dialog. If your MS-DOS program still doesn't run right, try restarting Windows in the MS-DOS mode. If it still won't work, Microsoft's product support is always available. In our next and final module, we're going to show you some tools that all Windows users should know about and use if they want their systems to continue running smoothly and efficiently. Okay, guys, now that we know how to use most of the features of Windows 95, how can I make sure that my system runs as fast as possible and stays in good working order?
The best way to make any Windows 95 machine run faster is to add more RAM, or random access memory. Now, depending on which applications you run and how much you're going to use services like the internet and the Microsoft network, we'd recommend that you have at least 12 to 16 megabytes of RAM.
Well, I know RAM's important, but it's also expensive. Got any other ways to make my system run faster?
Sure. Sometimes you can get corrupted files or damaged files, which can cause your system to crash. But Windows 95 includes a tool called Scan Disk, which will scan your hard drive and fix any errors that it finds. Let me show you how this works. Scan Disk is located under the Start button, Programs, Accessories, and System Tools. Now with Scan Disk, you can do a standard test, which will check each of your files and folders for any errors, and then fix the errors that it finds. Or you can do a thorough scan, which not only checks your files and folders, but also checks the physical surface of your hard disk. We recommend doing a standard test weekly and a thorough test every month. You should check this automatically fix errors option so that when ScanDisk finds an error, it will fix it and then continue on.
Now, another thing that can slow your system down is that in time, your files tend to get fragmented or scattered all over your hard drive. Then, when you want to use one of those files, it takes Windows longer to collect all the pieces and load them up. That's why you should keep your files and directories efficiently organized by using Disk Defragmenter. Disk Defragmenter is also in the System Tools folder, so again, click on the Start button, choose Programs, Accessories, and under System Tools, there's Disk Defragmenter. Just choose the hard disk that you want to defragment and click OK. Disk Defragmenter will organize your files and folders so Windows can read them faster.
Is there an easy way to schedule these tools to run in case I forget?
There is a scheduler included with Microsoft Plus, which is an add-on product for Windows 95. The scheduler is called the Microsoft Plus System Agent. Now, if you install Microsoft Plus, you'll see a new icon in the taskbar. Just double-click on this icon to bring up the System Agent.
The System Agent allows you to schedule programs to run at certain times. You'll notice that it already has ScanDisk Standard and Thorough and Disk Defragmenter scheduled to run. It tells us when it last started these tools, ended these tools, and the result. Now you can change the interval and times when these tools run. Let's schedule the Disk Defragmenter to run every Saturday at 9 p.m. Select Disk Defragmenter and click on Program, Change Schedule. Let's set it to weekly and 9 p.m. Let's change the day to Saturday by selecting it from the list. Of course, your PC has to be on for the tools to run. And to make sure that the tool doesn't interrupt your work, you can even set it to wait until you haven't used your computer for a certain period of time.
You should always run ScanDisk and Disk Defragmenter before installing new software. But since the new programs are so big, you might not have enough disk space to install them. Is there a way to increase hard disk space?
Windows has another tool called Drivespace, which compresses the information on your hard disk so you'll have more room to store other things. Let's take a look. Drivespace is also located under the Start button, Programs, Accessories, and System Tools. When Drivespace opens, notice that you can select the drive that you want to compress, which can be your C drive or even a floppy disk. Then choose Drive, Compress. Drivespace will show you how much additional hard disk space it estimates it can free up. Just click Start to compress your drive.
One thing that's very important with Drivespace is that you should back up any important files before running it. Now, it's unlikely that you'll have any problems with Drivespace because Microsoft tested it on about 1 million computers before it shipped. But if you have a pre-existing problem on your hard drive, running any compression program could cause a loss of data. So be sure to back up those important files.
So with just a few steps, I can free up enough hard disk space to install more programs. I'm sure a lot of you will be running Drivespace now that you know about it. Any other ways to optimize your system?
If your system is running slowly, you can find out if it's running optimally by checking its performance status. Right mouse click on My Computer, choose Properties, and select the Performance tab. This is where Windows 95 gives you information on the factors that impact your system's performance. The most significant of these is RAM, as we mentioned before. If you're running several applications at the same time, you'll want to have at least 12 megabytes of RAM. The next settings are also important for performance. Your file system setting should read 32-bit. This means that Windows is communicating with your hard drive using the fast 32-bit drivers. If it says 16-bit, that means that you're still running some old 16-bit drivers, which means that Windows is exchanging data with your hard drive at about half the speed of the 32-bit drivers. So you should contact Microsoft Product Support, or better yet, look at the Microsoft homepage up on the internet to see if there are updated 32-bit drivers for your system.
Notice below that Windows 95 states, your system is configured for optimal performance. Now, if you're not running optimally, Windows 95 will tell you what problems you're having, so you can either call technical support or try to fix them yourself, because after watching our Learn Windows 95 videos, you're well on your way to becoming an expert.
We hope you found from this tape that it's better to be a Windows expert than to let so many of its great capabilities remain unknown and unused. Concludes this video, but if you would like to order additional Winstruct videos, just call 800-242-4842. And from Keith, Tom, and myself, we'd like to thank you for choosing Winstruct for your software training needs. See you next time.